Hello, everyone. I know it's after lunch, so if you see me walking around stretching, this is probably my fourth week of recovering from spine and neck problems. So I'm so glad to be here. It's a pleasure and honor to speak after Stuart and all the other people, Nikita and everyone else's story. I have so much respect, and I was crying almost every person's story. It's okay to cry. We cry through, you know. I believe that it's okay. I want to tell you about the story of Lao Family and the Care Community Centers. And let me start off by first saying that I believe that homelessness is possible to overcome for the 180,000 people in California who is on any given night homeless. The reason I believe that is because 60+% of the people who are on our streets who are homeless, it's a situational homelessness. It can be overcome. 30+% are chronically, literally homeless. And so their challenge is more, it's different because they may have severe mental health, they may have severe alcohol, behavioral, drugs, and trauma. And that's okay. We don't need to be defined by something that we're going through or something that we're experiencing. It's who, a part of who we are. And if we are more tolerant as an employer, more tolerant as a landlord, more tolerant as a neighbor or family, and we need the skills and the training too when we have a family member who is experiencing those situations, we need the counseling too so we can be the best and have the capability providing the love that they need to overcome their medical condition. So we can restore homelessness, but I'm gonna take you on a journey for a second, and if you can imagine, I'm gonna give you two scenarios to imagine. The first scenario is, imagine that we are working within the current system that we have, and that's the coordinated care entry system. Housing first, harm reduction. What that means is that when you see a neighbor or someone on the street or a colleague or a church member, someone who is experiencing homelessness or on the sidewalk, and you want to do something, and you call 911 or 311 or 211, they're supposed to send an outreach person to come and do an intake or an introduction. Sometimes it can take 2 weeks or it could be 2 months before they come and that person is gone. And then the next step is the government entity, the county or the city, has to contact an organization who is authorized to conduct a HMIS assessment, Homeless Management Information System and assessment. They need to have an account, they need to have an MOU, and then they can do the assessment. But it might be a month or two or even 3, 4, 5, 6 months before they can do an assessment for that homeless individual. After they do that, they put them into a black hole. And that black hole, because when you do the assessment, it has a vulnerability index. And so then when you do ask the questions and do the assessment and they don't score high enough because they weren't somebody that came out of ER. They didn't come out of a nursing home. They didn't come out of ER, so they didn't score high enough. So they're just in the black hole and they can't get a room or a bed. So 180 days later, 360, 580 days later, they're still out there. How do you feel about what I just described to you? It's happening in California, in San Francisco, all over the United States. That is what we have right now. Okay, now I'm gonna take you to another scenario. Imagine this, your congregation, there's somebody in your church or somebody that you walk by every day when you go to, you know, the bus or to go to work who's homeless. You call an organization like a Lao family who has a care community center or a care campus. The minute they call, I can send one of my staff, like Denise, or one of my other staff to go meet them where they're at the encampment or the sidewalk. You can send them to my office, and within minutes, they'll get an appointment in person. And we'll do the assessment and intake, and we'll help them to get their driver's license, their social security card, their California ID, apply for public benefits so they can get nutrition and food, they can get clothing, and then we can enroll them into Medi-Cal and get them a primary care doctor and a behavioral health therapist. And they're wrapped around with a case manager for workforce, a navigator for healthcare, you know, a mental health counselor, a job coach. Each person will get wrapped around with five or six support. And then we can get them into job service and pre-readiness. I can bring the employer to come to the office. We can pay for their bus fare, their BART, give them a bike, pay for a Lyft for them or Uber to get to the appointment. Once they have the job, we open the bank account. The bank comes to our office to take their contribution, I mean their savings. And then we get them a job within 1 month. Or 2 months or 3 months. And they have credit now. They're beginning to get rebanked and develop credit. And they're saving, okay? And then now they have life skill training through a life skill coach. We have the spiritual leaders who come to do, you know, or 12-step program. They have a doctor on site. They have skills training, whether it's digital training, like through Love Never Fails, our partners, or we work with Goodwill, or we're working with Roots Clinic. But we have all of these different providers located together in one space. Because the drop rate, when you have to connect somebody who doesn't have a car and you have them travel throughout the city, it's really hard for them to get what they need to do. So what I just spoke about, it's known as an integrated case management model. This is a nationally recognized model. It's called, because it's team focused. It needs to be integrated with services that's inside and outside, because we can't do everything. We just can't. We shouldn't. There are other people who can do things better than us. And the doctor should do the doctor stuff. The attorney should do the attorney stuff. The, you know, like the spiritual partner should do the spiritual things. You know, clothing should do clothing. The job coaches should do the job coaches. So we have a place that we all could gather together. We need to communicate across. That's what integrated means. It means comprehensive. It's not silos. And then I think nonprofits, it's important for us to have accreditation, because we need to demonstrate that we have quality service, you know, and that we're accountable. We deliver outcomes. You know, Ted talked about earlier, so this is Lao Family Service Model from day one when we first started as refugees. Who better to know what a person who has no home and having to learn everything than a homeless former refugee person? I was homeless. Our family was homeless for 3 years. We came to San Francisco, and we lived in a single room occupancy in the Tenderloin. We had to learn English. I had to learn how to vote, then to become a mayor of a city in the Bay Area, to graduate from college, to learn how to bank, how to vote, you know, how to use our banking system, the loan system. This is what people don't talk about. You need credit. You build them this beautiful 1.4 million affordable housing, one unit, and you're taking them from a condition of class D on the street to class A building, and they need life skill, they need jobs, they need to be able to maintain it. So the system that we have doesn't work right now. Okay, we need to change the status quo. This is to demonstrate to you that in 43 years, it took the dedication of so many generations to put all of these programs in place. This is 50 plus contracts. These contracts have been in place for 40 years, some of them. That means you have to be outcomes oriented. You need to give a deliverable to the person that is concrete. Information and referral is good, but give them a job, give them housing, give them a car, give them health insurance, give them something concrete, please. Okay. We need to impact, and we can continue to impact through this model. We can create more care community centers and more care campuses. Let me give you an example. This was the largest vacant motel in the state of California, 285 rooms. We bought it from G6 Hospitality. It was the only hotel they sold to a charity in the United States. They wouldn't even return our call, but we were able to buy it in 65 days. And we duplicated again in going to Sacramento downtown and got this Vagabond Hotel, 107. And we opened that last weekend. Next week, Monday, we're opening a former Comfort Inn, 117 units. We can duplicate this and do this across America, across California. Okay, so my takeaway for you and my conclusion is this. We're here together, amazing people in this room and amazing skills. Let us connect and let us commit. We need to commit. So we can commit by signing a memorandum of understanding, a non-financial document between us so we can be accountable for each other and the people that we're supposed to serve. And that's deliver. Let's deliver something concrete. Because otherwise, we just spend a beautiful day in this beautiful place. Yaniv, thank you. Beautiful food, amazing food. We met these people, but what are we going to do from this? So I think I'm in like 59 second overtime, or I might have one minute. But okay, I'm in overtime? Okay, so these are just, I would call them filler slides. They're not really the most substantial slides. But what I want to say is this, is that, again, we can do something. Remember, 60%+ of people who are homeless is a situational homelessness. And let me share that in the last 6 years, we helped 6,000 people go from homelessness to permanent housing. 5%, we were able to help them through our partnerships in less than 6 months. And then 90% did it in 6 months to 12 months. And then 5%, it took about 12 months to 18 months to achieve. So that means we can do it. We have the technology, we have the wealth, we have the capability, and we cannot count on the government to solve it for us. We all in here can solve it, and we can work together to do it. Thank you.
Where, okay, yeah, they can hear me. Yeah, stay up here. We have time for one question. Yaniv asked me earlier how the day was going, and I said, ask me in a few hours at the end of the day. I have an answer for you now. I'm killing it. This is killing it. I'm connecting the dots. I was going to get up and say what she just said. I think you guys might have missed that, okay? The last point she made, basically in 12, you just said that in 12 months, you graduated 100% of the people, right?
Yes. I mean, 3%. Because they tried to harm themselves or others, we had to transition them to another organization. But like our campus that you came to visit, Care Campus in Oakland, the Motel 6, 115 people out of 150 units graduated already.
This just someone who has integrity and knows her stuff. She corrects me. They have a 3%. It's not a fail rate, warm handoff rate. Yes. 97% of chronically homeless and the reentry population come to their home. 97% of them within 1 year are independent, graduated, you know, integrated into society. And they also have a safety net because they have a community. And if they get in trouble again, they just come back. And it's amazing. My takeaway, I'll tell you what my takeaway is. I'm putting together, you know, connecting the dots, you know, like Brett said something. It's like, we always want somebody to blame. Stop blaming. Because, I mean, I'm a person of faith, so, you know, you can imagine this interpreted in your own way. When I get to the end of my life, before the judgment seat, He's not going to hold me accountable for what Gavin Newsom did or did not do. And I love to spout out at all of you the power that's in this room, but it's kind of hitting me right now. We're the ones that are going to be responsible. Probably shouldn't have come here. We've just heard this. We're responsible for this. Folks, we can turn this around. We've heard from these people that we see. I mean, they are the powerful change agents. And we just need to be a catalyst. And the power is in this room. Wow. Okay. We have time for one question and then we have to move on. Okay.
Thank you so much. So you spoke very eloquently about the issues with the existing system here in San Francisco and in California, and about the need to really, you know, take matters into our own hand and just how much more efficiently we can provide these services and not have this red tape in the way. You know, how are those conversations that you're having with other service providers, and do people understand the need to do that, and how's the reception of other people to, you know, that way of thinking?
Well, you know, when you read the San Francisco Business Times or the Chronicle and the Bee and the Tribune, you know, East Bay Times, all the nonprofits, I think, know exactly what I'm talking about. Like, I was hearing, like, yes and yes, they exactly know what I'm talking about. So what's happening is that there are a few individuals who come to Board of Supervisor meetings and who go to city council meetings and who go talk to our governor, our senator, and they say that this coordinated care is the only way and the way that we have to go. It's finally being challenged now what adequate housing is. And so I think our government, public officials, being a recovering public official myself, you know, we understand the things that we can't do. And so everyone's concerned about claims and lawsuits, right? And so they know that the affordable housing system of developing housing from ground up construction at $1.4 million and 7.5 years average is too expensive and we cannot build our way out. So I think a lot of people support what we're saying, but then they haven't been able to solve it through the case law of how to overturn or come up with some sort of solution that's a workaround. So we are creating workarounds. And so what we need is law firms to adopt us, medical groups to adopt us, CPA firms to adopt us, tech to adopt us, so that we can do what we can deliver. Because the tech firms, you know, software, my husband's in software. Okay, after you design the software and everything else is high margins of profit. Okay? And so then the tech people may not be able to do it, but we can use technology for our work. But the tech industry can support us financially to give unrestricted funds and partner with us so that we can execute. Because listen, each of those hotels that I just showed to you, it was 65 to 80 days for us to get those property turned around. So if we built that Motel 6, that would have cost us $300 million to build. We got it for $25 million, and it was still hard for us. $25 million is really hard for us still. So, like the guy who owns the Comfort Inn, he and I had a handshake 80 days ago. He advanced 200,000, we advanced 550,000. And then we signed an agreement only a few days ago, and we did all of this 80 days ago. So it's, you can't trust everybody, you know, on a handshake, but you have to make a decision whether that person is going to screw you or are they going to like really come through. You know what I mean? And we're proving it with 18 projects already. So we're reliable. Okay? And our people are gold and they're diamonds that we can just like polish.
Well, let's do that. You know.